the name of one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Sometimes I wonder why in the world do the disciples continue to follow Jesus? After all, he can be, well, so far. His language can be not very dramatic, but difficult and challenging. And yet, they are an example. Harsh. Jesus said, whoever is not against us is for us. Perplexing the disciples. And probably us. Yet again. If we look closely at the teachings of Jesus, if we, through our imagination, live into his encounter with friends and enemies, we can't help but learn something about human nature. It is certainly true in this encounter. Paul the Apostle reminds us that we are being saved. We are redeemed, and we are being redeemed. It is a process. A lifelong process. And in this story, we understand something about human nature. We know, for example, early humans developed tribal markers and rituals to distinguish themselves from other tribes. And one of those markers and its rituals was religion. Jesus puts it this way to his disciples. Is this what religion is for? To distinguish your tribe from that tribe. It often seems that way when we pay attention to Jesus' encounters. It certainly seems that way even now in the 21st century. The distinction, as you know, is far more political than religious or theological. But Jesus says, the one who is not against us is for us, forcing his disciples then and now to rethink the category of us and them. In our gospel reading, the disciples know that someone casted out demons in Jesus' name. And how do they respond? They respond by acting like bouncers, barring the door. Jesus tried something. If he was not following you and us. And Jesus responds, do not stop him. For no one who does the deed of power my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. Upon further review, I've been watching too much football. Upon further review and reflection, I'm reminded that our inclination for spiritual gatekeeping is a long, long history. Historically, I'm often reminded that God has to spend a lot of time, a lot of energy, growing over the door, we run around judging. This is a cautionary tale found in the Gospel of Mark. It's a cautionary tale for us. We must come to terms and embrace our history, and we must also realize how ironic at least it is when we feel more zealous about the order of God's kingdom than God. Why are we so much better at others and judging different than we are at seeing and celebrating somehow? Well, Jesus pointed out to the disciples something about that unredeemed part of our human nature that prefers this way of seeing the world. Up and then. The disciples get all stirred up, and an outsider exercises Jesus' name. Even though he is out there doing something good, they either ignore or just can't see or believe that he is alleviating suffering. He's healing brokenness. He's restoring people to community. And he is trusting in the name of Jesus to provide powerful and necessary healing. Here's the problem for the disciples. He's not doing any of these things in the right way, in the prescribed way. He's doing it differently. He's doing it outside the plane. He's doing it outside the margin. He's outside of the box. He's away from where the disciples might wield influence and control over his work. He's not following God. They tell Jesus. He's not in our group. And Jesus doesn't give their response much credence. The fact of the matter is, as you know, on this journey that Jesus is taking from Galilee to Jerusalem, Sunday after Sunday, or in reality, day after day, Jesus is far too focused on what really matters. The culmination of his ministry on the cross. And he is not going to waste time on gatekeeping. Pay attention to what really matters. He seems to be saying and pleading to the disciples and to us. Faith is hard. So much is at stake. What you say, and what you do, and what you focus on, what you prioritize with my disciples, these things matter. So look, Jesus said, look at the stumbling block you place in front of yourself and each other. Look at the perverse pleasure you take, says the disciples, in excluding people who live, believe, worship, serve, and practice their faith differently than you do. You might as well have been saying, look at how insecure and how tenuous your own faith must be. If it's survival depends on you tearing down someone else's faith. And so, encounter with disciples draws closer and closer to the world in which we live in our very own lives. Stop being stumbling blocks, he says. Stop being bouncers. Stop making faith harder for yourself than for others. It is already difficult. I made all over again. Every time I open my heart and my mind to the story, Jesus still tells. When I immerse myself in his openness, his inclusivity, his hospitality, and all that is revealed in this account. And every time I think I've made my personal circle wide enough, Jesus says to me, no, wider, wider. There is no room for complacency, Jesus said. Our circle of welcome must be wider and wider yet. Whoever finds us before us, what an amazing declaration of faith from the mouth of Jesus. Think about it. Whoever does not oppose the beautiful and redeeming work of God, mercy, love, kindness, justice, liberation, peacemaking, healing, nurturing, is on Jesus' side. And our work is to welcome them, hope them, include them, and love them. I know the language Jesus uses seems harsh and unforgiving, but I do not believe Jesus means to condemn us with this language. Taken in its totality, the narrative is not about condemnation. It is about reality. It's about human sin. It is about the estrangement of self from God and others still in need of redemption. It's about human beings. Isn't it true that at some point, at least some of the time, we exclude? At least some of the time, we judge. There is that temptation, especially with all social platforms available, to demonize, to use words, cut, humiliate another human being. Isn't it true that sometimes we compare and we divide and we determine who is really in and who is out? We designate God. But the truth is, we are called to be God's generous and welcoming hosts. Hosts who throw open the doors of the kingdom wide open. Hosts who understand that there is enough of God to go around. God's goodness, God's mercy, God's justice. We are called to be hosts who trust that God can handle our diversity and difference. Yes, God is big enough to do that. And God is big enough to delight. We are called to be hosts who respond with joy and gratitude whenever the power God in the name of Jesus. Whoever is not against us, for us. Isn't it true that if we pay attention to those parts of ourselves that are being redeemed, we can continue as redeemers with open minds, open hearts,